Okay, with that, let's actually get started now. Thank you for everyone who's joined us today. Welcome to the first webinar of 2020. And our topic we are going to be discussing today is successful omnichannel commerce strategies for 2020 and beyond. I'm your host, Rebecca George. I'm here I'm part of the marketing team at Capillary. And I'm really honored to be joined by our speakers today. The first speaker is Anand Viswanath, who is the National Marketing Manager of Retail and Digital for TTK Prestige. Anand comes in with over 14 years of experience in sales and marketing and is currently leading digital marketing and omnichannel e-commerce for TTK Prestige. As a lot of you know, that's a brand that's been a kitchenware brand that's been around for a really long time, one of the oldest business houses in India today. We also have joined with us Vinit Dubey, who's the principal product manager at Capillary Technologies with over 10 years of experience in building cloud technology product. Thank you so much for joining us today, Vinit and Anand. Really glad to have you here. So before we get started, a few housekeeping rules. Note that all lines are for participants are muted at this moment, but towards the end of the session, we'll have a Q&A round and you'll be unmuted and you can drop your question in the chat. If you do get dropped off from the meeting, please go back to the same registration link and you'll be able to jump back on. So let's discuss what our webinar today is about, which is omnichannel. Now, omnichannel is not a new buzzword. This is a concept we've been hearing about for, I'd say, close to a decade now. Consumers are already using omnichannel while they shop. We know this because, like me and probably like most of you, nearly 75% of shoppers use multiple channels or multiple devices when they're comparing prices, hunting for discounts, shopping. And studies do show that the more channels a consumer uses, they have a higher spend as a customer. And in very recent years, we're also seeing the introduction of social commerce, especially in younger shoppers. Instagram accounts for about 130 million users clicking on shopping posts every month to learn about products. So clearly, customers today are ready for omnichannel. And although most brands are aware of the importance of omnichannel commerce today, a lot of brands fail to deliver on this experience. Again, research shows that there are common reasons for this, those reasons being lack of internal organization, the inability to identify customers across their shopping trips, the kind of data quality that's picked up from the shoppers, the lack of analytics for the data, and a siloed organization. Now, what do these points or what do these challenges really look like at a ground level? And what do they look like when a brand faces them? So with that, let's turn to our speakers to hear from them based on their industry experience. Anand, from TTK Prestige, can you tell us a little bit more about the brand, TTK Prestige as a brand, and how the brand has evolved? And what motivated the brand to adopt an omnichannel approach in today's day?
Hi everyone, this is Anand here. I am from TTK Prestige Ltd. Thanks Rebecca for the introduction, and it's really nice to have Capillary Technologies invite me for this webinar. A little about TTK Prestige as a brand. It's a very, very old company. Probably it's one of the oldest business houses in India. And Prestige is a household name. So if you just look at the brand, I don't think there is any middle class family which doesn't own a Prestige product, especially the pressure cooker. From a brand point of view, it's a vastly distributed brand, which means right from the local mom and pop store to a big bazaar to an army canteen to exclusive stores to the traditional dealer distribution channel and online in marketplaces as well as with our own company website. the same product is actually distributed throughout the market. We have presence even in teleoperating companies. We also sell to rural channels. So it's actually the whole market as a gamut. Okay. So that's the key strength of this brand. It's a huge brand, huge recall, and a vastly distributed brand. So what's the core philosophy like? As a brand, we stand for trust, transparency, and knowledge. So all the products that we launch in the market, they are built on some pillars, basically of innovation, health, convenience, modern looking appliances. So these are some of the ways, or these are some of the product development thought processes that we follow. That being said, marketing and reaching out to the consumers is a very big factor in the way we do our business. And as a company, we are very, very aggressive in terms of how we reach out to the customers. Wherever the customers go, we basically follow them, or we lead that particular market. So that's what TTK Prestige stands for. Like I explained, the brand is present everywhere. Now, in the last decade or so, what we have seen is there is a lot of internet penetration that has happened, and the whole way the consumers have changed their buying habits, or the way they are exploring or interacting with the brand, has changed drastically. So as a brand, we also had to adapt to this channel churn, as well as to the kind of mix of customers coming in multiple formats and interacting with the brand in different ways. And having a uniform appearance or uniform view of TTK Prestige became very important for us. We realized that the channel partners played a very big important role in creating the impression of branding of the company. And so we opened our own company exclusive brand outlets about 15 years back. And today, as we speak, there are more than 580 showrooms across 340 towns in India. And Prestige Exclusive, the retail arm of TTK Prestige, is a big, big retail chain of stores. Now, this being said, this is only a small part of our business. Our major part of business still comes from the traditional trade and the other channels. TTK, the Prestige Exclusive brand, is the best face of the brand. And in this store, we have actually developed a lot of interesting methods to actually give customers a very, very good shopping experience. So we have things like exchange. We have things like round the year offers and promotions. We have a good CRM engine. Then we have got interesting options for buying the same product. Now, all this has been made possible because we wanted to own that space and be the top of mind and the best brand in kitchen category, and really delight our customers. The moment Omnichannel, so to say, started, so we were faced with a situation where now the same customer is going to different platforms or different modes to interact with the brand. So at one point of time, what we saw is there is a little bit of online e-commerce which started affecting us. Then we saw that e-commerce is not avoidable. So we had to embrace it, and we had to become join hands with it. So these kind of market challenges forced us to actually evolve. And we decided that Omnichannel should be a big strategy for us. And how do we make customers interact with us across different platforms, but at the same time get the same brand experience? So that is what motivated us.
Okay.
We wanted to really communicate in a single way, in a uniform way with our brand, with our customers. And that's why we started focusing on Omnichannel as a medium.
Okay. That's really interesting to know the evolution of this brand and everything, because this seems like a quintessential traditional brand that's innovative and looking at different methods of reaching our customers. So So Anand, like, can you help us understand what a traditional brand can do when they're looking to go omnichannel? What are like the steps that every brand needs to think about when they take that move?
Okay. So when it comes to going online or going the omnichannel route, very important that as a large organization, there should be some kind of a clear-cut strategic objective which is actually set around it. Because the initiative like going omnichannel is a very, very, very expensive affair, and it requires a lot of processes, and it requires for good tech partner to partner with. So one good thing that TTK Prestige has done is we have been in the online space, selling online as well as with our e-commerce website for more than 8 years now. And in this entire journey, what we have seen is there are some baby steps which has to be taken to start the whole journey. So what are the baby steps like? First and foremost, it is that the website experience, company brand website experience, should be very good. Because today people are all seeing the other e-commerce giants like an Amazon or a Flipkart as a benchmark to what is the kind of content that should be provided, what is the kind of shopping experience or ease of checkout that should be provided, and the whole experience of delivery and fulfillment. So that's their expectation. So in case if someone is getting into a own branded e-commerce website and not living up to a particular standard, huge challenge, customers will just desert and go away. That's number one. Second thing that is there is we wanted to ensure that the marketplaces where we are selling, we are able to optimize our inventory across marketplaces. This may sound very simple, but it is quite complex because you have different marketplaces, each of them wanting you to sell exclusively only in their platform. And as a business manager, I always want to optimize my inventory. I don't want to keep huge stocks. So how do we manage with same inventory going across to different websites? So that was another challenge which we had to solve. Third thing that we were looking at is in terms of our digital marketing as well as our spends, we wanted to ensure that the discoverability online has to be very, very good. So whatever the brand stands for, whatever the product stands for, whatever is the product features as well as their benefits should be simply and effectively communicated in the online space as well. Because especially today, a lot of small brands are coming. And when those brands come, they are all very, very eager to compete with the stalwarts. So we have to live up to that expectation of the customer that he will get best in class, best in category kind of product knowledge and product information. And at the same time, he should be able to get genuine or proper information about the products in the online space. Fourth point which is there is when it comes to our stores, somewhere the store has to get linked and the POS, point of sale application system, should also get linked to the online space. So how we can enable the offline to online transition as well as the online to offline transition. So for example, if a customer comes online and he sees the latest and innovative product, but then he is not willing to immediately buy, he should be able to go offline to a store which has stock and at the same time be able to see those products. So the discoverability of products is something which is very, very essential. Similarly, at a store level, if a store doesn't have stocks for a particular SKU, how can online help them? How can we fulfill it from a warehouse and actually not have a loss of sale situation? So how to optimize my inventory at the store and as well as how to optimize my inventory which is at the warehouse and fulfill that order to the customer. So these are some of the baby steps which we have taken, and in this path we have found that Capillary has been quite instrumental in giving a robust technology for us to enable this kind of a business process.
In terms of, like, can you tell us about the challenges that, you know, there are associated with going omnichannel?
The challenges, there are quite a lot of challenges. I think Rebecca's introduction in the beginning was quite insightful, where she captures what all are the percentage and how do people face challenges while going omnicommerce. From our side, we had some specific use cases which were very integral to consumer durable or a kitchen appliance category. So one challenge that we faced was how do you enable a trade-in kind of a workflow? So that was one challenge which we faced. Second challenge that we faced was when it comes to your POS as well as the ERP. We have ERP SAP at the back end and we have an in-house POS at the stores. So how do we integrate all three systems? So this was again one big challenge because we can't really have each vendor working in silos or each. So it has to be one common free flow kind of a solution that has to be done. Third challenge that we figured out was that in our business, there is something called as a batch. So the same SKU is actually sold at different, the manufacturing, the MRP is actually different based on where it is produced as well as when it was produced. So now when the order is picked up, so in online space, what happens in any marketplace? One SKU, one MRP, one selling price. This is what they follow. But practically, the stock that we have, maybe it is 6 months old, 1 year old, 2 years old, we actually have same SKU, but we have different MRPs. Now the reviews and ratings cannot be transferred from one SKU to the another SKU. So which means I have to maintain the same SKU online and at the same time ensure that this batch complexity is addressed. I can never have a situation where a customer has actually paid more for the product online and then I end up dispatching an older MRP stock, which should have been sold at a lesser selling price. So this was a very big challenge that we had to overcome. And there was a lot of solutioning which had to be done to make this possible. Another important part which we faced was in terms of the tech partner selection. Because it was a very new business or a new channel for us. So how much to invest and whom to partner with. This was always a chicken and egg kind of a issue. In TTK Prestige, one good thing that happened was this omnichannel, going omnichannel, was decided as one of the key strategic objectives by the company, led by a very senior vice president designation person who led this entire project. So management will was there and there was a lot of commitment in terms of time as well as effort. So to iterate and to make mistake and to actually fine tune this entire process. So that was something which was a challenge which we faced and which we overcame. Another thing was the tech partner selection. So tech partner wise, we wanted someone who understood our business and at the same time who could customize their solutions as per our workflows. So this is where we found a good tech partner in Capillary Technologies and they were more than willing to understand our requirement as well as fine tune the business processes and the internal systems to solve all our challenges. So having a good tech partner is very, very essential if any brand wants to succeed in this entire omnichannel space.
Right. And that's really insightful. So for my takeaways, you know, for Prestige as a brand, it was having the same vision really helped, and having a strong tech partner was helped in like overcoming those challenges. Okay, thank you so much for that insight, Anand. Now, so this is what we've been discussing to all our attendees out there. You know, what we've been discussing so far is the steps that a brand can take and the challenges that they might hit. But now, what are we seeing in 2020 when it comes to omnichannel and delivering a strong omnichannel experience? What are the core focus areas that a brand needs to look at? So with that, bring in Vinit. Vinit is going to tell us a little bit about what omnichannel commerce strategies a brand needs to focus on when considering their 2020 vision. Over to you.
Thanks, Rebecca. What I'll do is just let me tell you over the past 5 years what sort of trends in customers' demand that I've seen being a product manager. And obviously, I'll tell you what is happening now and what I see demands coming now, right? So 4 or 5 years back, when people talked about omnichannel, it was mostly around they wanted to use their stores as a fulfillment center. So they just wanted to enable journeys like you buy online and you pick up from store, or basically just using stores to deliver orders at home. So they wanted to use the infra of these stores for all the offline brands. And from the product or tech standpoint, they needed a very strong order management system so that the OMS system can figure out which is the store nearest to the customer and help route the order there. And so that from there, the order can be fulfilled. And that went on for a couple of years. And then people thought that, okay, if anyway, we are just leading the online customers towards offline, why not do the otherwise as well? So then all of this things around your endless aisle or loss of sale app also came in. So then people wanted tech products so that when customers come in the store and they don't find any size they want. So either the customer or the store staff should be able to help the customer make that purchase, right? So this was again the reverse of the first thing. And then very recently now customers have sort of moved beyond the only fulfillment side of things. Now when I talk to customers who are figuring out their omnichannel strategies, now they also want to address other aspects of your omnichannel customer journey as well. They wanted seamless pricing and promotions as well. So they want to say that the price and the various store promotions that I'm offering on my offline network, similar things have to be powered on an online channels as well. So it's not that the online promotions are going to be separate and offline are going to be separate. They want a seamless integration between their point of sale and ERP so that they have a single system of record for their pricing and promotion, and the same flows to all the various channels on the system, right? Similarly, in terms of payments as well. Now, let's say a brand like Prestige, if they are offering EMIs or other modes of loyalty kind of payment modes in store, similarly, the brands also want to power the same types of payments use cases on the online storefront as well, right? Then again comes your recommendations, right? So even on the recommendation side, brands want the recommendations to take into account customers' offline data as well as online purchase and behavior data, so that you deliver the same kind of product recommendations, whether the customer is on your endless aisle or whether the customer is your online store, right? So basically, this is going beyond fulfillment. It is not just only you're using your offline network, but you're also using the data of your all offline channels, and you are giving the whole consistent experience. So I would say that in 2020 and beyond, as end customers who are engaging with brand and also as brand themselves, people want to have consistent experiences in terms of pricing, in terms of promotion, recommendation, payment, fulfillment, everything. And otherwise, the buying experiences as well. So one good example with Anand talked about. So in their stores, they are allowing customers to exchange their old products. Similar will be customers' expectation on the front end, on the online site as well. You can't have different buying experiences on online as well as offline, right? So customers want consistent experiences, and that's what brands are focusing on in 2020 and beyond.
Thank you so much, Vinit, for that insight. Now I want to open the webinar out to our guests who are here. Does anyone have any questions that either Anand or Vinit can address for you? You can type in your question in the chat panel. I see. So Gopala K has a question. How much does the online channel contribute to total brand revenue? Is online the fastest growing channel? So I think Anand would be quite suited to answer this question. I do remember you mentioning that retail is still your biggest the bringer of business. Please, if you want to take that question in more depth.
Without getting into percentages or very specific numbers, the online channels are currently contributing in double digits. So that's a big thing from any brand point of view. So being a small channel, which is hardly, say the marketplace's business is hardly 3 to 4 years old, and that actually contributing in double digits is a very big thing. And is it the fastest growing channel? Yes. Today, online business is the fastest growing, and in that space, the marketplace business is growing rapidly. So the idea is to grow our brand store and the brand online business also in the same speed, but definitely marketplaces are growing very, very fast.
I hope that answers you. Are there any other questions from the attendees? While we're waiting for more questions, I actually have a question around a trending. So in the, you know, here in marketing, while we're researching different trends and topics, I also see like social commerce come up a lot. Now, just to throw out this question to both Vinit and Anand, you know, is social commerce, do we foresee, is that a important topic, let's say for Prestige, you know, have you seen any interaction on social platforms? So are you looking at that as future potential?
Well, the amount of time that people are spending on Facebook and WhatsApp, it's the place to be in, because now no longer people are actually searching on Google and then going elsewhere. So yes, social commerce is going to come up. As a brand, we have not yet ventured into it. So we have had couple of experiments which we have run where we have tried to sell on Facebook and all, but then those were all at a very small pilot level, not yet caught on, but I'm sure definitely within the next 1 to 2 years this is going to be something which will pick up steam.
Okay, and we have one more question that's come in from an anonymous attendee. How is the SaaS commerce adaptation in India or in emerging economies? What are your opinions on
that? Is this for Vinit or me?
Yep, I'll take this one. So I think that that's a sort of a, not just a baby step. So when I look at SaaS commerce, I think the question is around whether one should look at a product like Anywhere Commerce or your Shopify Big Commerce, or one should look at large installations like Hybris or IBM, like that. So I think there right now the SaaS platforms have matured a lot, and it's not that when one considers a SaaS platform, it's not just saving in terms of pay as you go. So that is not the only selling point when we go to our customers, that it, you just have to pay for what you use and you don't have to invest in big Hybris or IBM and all. There, the thing is that SaaS platforms also come with a lot of tuning of the performance and scalability side of elements as well. So if you go with a on-premise kind of a product, then the brand will have to own the scaling, infra, performance, all of those kind of things. And performance becomes too critical for any online site, right? I mean, if the as and when your demand grows up, you'll maybe have to add up more servers, reduce servers. I mean, it's a full-time thing which will have to come out to be. Whereas if you are looking at a SaaS platform, be it any, the whole performance side is taken care of by the service provider. So I think that way, brands these days are more and more leaning towards SaaS platforms. Some of the brands do have concerns around the data security aspects of that. So for that, again, SaaS platforms are having good, robust policies, and they have their in-house infosec and data security teams. And so that there are necessary policies which do give comfort to the brands that a SaaS platform will be able to solve their data security needs. So yeah, so in conclusion, yes, SaaS platforms are the go-to platform these days. And you, in terms of from right from anywhere commerce to Shopify to your Salesforce demandware. So all these products are on SaaS and they are all seeing good traction in the market.
Thank you for that, Vinit. Okay, we have one more question. I think we'll keep this as the final question before we close out. So the question is, do you see, and I think this would be more suited for Anand, but Vinit, please chip in if with any points you may have. Do you see the marketplace as an opportunity or threat? How do you plan to take on giants like Amazon? Most retailers fear Amazon since it undercut a brand's presence to generate their ad revenue. Also, Amazon is introducing more and more of its own brands, given the rich data they have of a million sellers. Yeah, this is a very it's a big question that we keep hearing. But yes, Anand, I'd love to hear that from you as well.
I think when we see marketplace, initially for about 3 to 6 months, we actually saw it as a competition. But slowly and steadily, we realized that this online space marketplace is here to stay. The kind of customers which the marketplace gives is very different from the traditional customers that we have been getting from our other channels. For example, penetrating into newer markets or going down the population strata. So those kind of stuff, the online marketplaces are able to make people try, make people switch, or make people experience a brand for the first time. So they are doing a lot of good work, and we decided to ride the wave. Now, is it a threat? The thing is like this, if you keep on adding value to the customers, and if you understand your customers well, then there is no threat. For example, we believe in innovation. So when it comes to product development, there are huge number of SKUs that are launched every year. More than 100-120 new SKUs have been launched every year for the past 5 years. Now that kind of R&D, no Amazon can ever do. So in a typical sense, I would call Prestige as the category killer or the category leader. So there is no way that there is any marketplace or any small brand is going to actually come and compete with us. It is something which we have partnered with and we will continue to grow together. So that's our approach when it comes to any kind of threat, perceived threat that you may think of.
Okay, I hope that answered your question, Gopala. All right, let me just check if we have any more questions. Actually, we'll close out with that. Thank you so much, Anand. Thank you so much, Vinit. Thank you for everyone who joined this webinar, January's webinar session. We will be having more webinars in the future, maybe in the upcoming month. And hope to see you again soon. Thank you for everyone who joined. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.